It's the Time Excellence Show, episode 103. Hi, I'm Douglas Calvin, and the Time Excellence Show is where we prospect for time, discovering nuggets of time opportunity to make more of a difference in your organization, your career, and your personal life. In today's show, we are in episode 103, and we are going to look at a real-time situation. We're going to examine Kathryn's advice. She gives us advice and lets us know how many friends we should have. Well, not exactly, but stick around, you'll find out. And I am going to be joined by Janet Calvin, my wife, who will help us to explore this interesting story where there's a lot of time excellence lessons to learn. Stay tuned. Time Excellence, the key to making more of a difference today by maximizing time for organizational, career, and personal achievement. We invite you to join us for each episode of the Time Excellence Show to write an even brighter chapter in your life, one of hope, growth, and purpose. The Time Excellence Show, prospecting for time together. Well, this is a great segment. Welcome back. And we're going to be talking about Kathryn's advice. How many friends is the question? And joining me is my wife, Janet Calvin.
Hi.
She's going to help balance this discussion out because we're going to look at a real time situation. This is something that someone has put their heart into. Kathryn has told us some information, and we're going to balance those against time excellence principles and see if they make sense and how they might apply to each of our lives. All right. So this is what Kathryn says. Janet, you want to start us off with what Kathryn is situation is?
I'm another not technically single mom, but DH's job requires frequent extended travel. So I function as a single mom 50 to 70% of the time.
Okay, so single mom, but she's not. What's her situation? She's a single mom, but she's not. She feels, I think, like a single mom. And we get that feeling. She talks about DH. DH, I assume.
It's probably her husband.
Yeah, it's probably her husband. Frequent extended travel.
Well, I can relate to her. I remember way back a number of years ago when you actually worked across town and you were gone from like 6 a.m. until 10 p.m. Because you had a long commute and you worked long hours. And so there was times when our children didn't get to see you for a few days because you were gone traveling. And then you also traveled out of town quite a bit. So I actually understand how Kathryn feels.
Yeah. There's probably a lot of people that can relate. You know, we talk about single parents and they're actually very time crunched, but you can be married and also have the same characteristics of being single. And that's what Kathryn, we think, is really trying to express. In fact, she's saying 50 to 75% of the time. Sounds like a sales job to me, that he's maybe got a sales job. It doesn't say whether she works or not. So we don't know. We just have to guess. But that would make it even more time stress. So Kathryn's situation, I think we can all relate to at some point in our lives, especially if we have kids. And we're going to learn in a second that Kathryn does have kids. All right. And she continues.
Streamlining our routine and having a definite end to my day are probably the most useful to me on a day-to-day basis.
All right. So right here, Kathryn's a pretty smart woman. She has consciously streamlined her routine. Now, the Time Excellence Show is really about that subject. It's really about the 7 steps that takes us through it. And Kathryn has probably done a lot of good things. You know, a lot of Time Excellence is common sense, But there are other principles that are exactly opposite that. So Kathryn is feeling as though she's made some progress in routine. When I think of routine, what kind of things come to mind when you think of the routine things that Kathryn may be having to do?
Well, if you have small children or you have children at home, it would be getting them up, getting breakfast on the table, getting their lunches made if they go to school, getting them out the door, maybe taking them to either a daycare or a preschool or to their regular school. Then it's the picking them up, and then perhaps it's taking them to activities after school. And then you add into all that grocery shopping and doing the laundry and just all the daily chores that go on day after day after day.
Sure. We think about those chores, and in previous episodes, we've talked about firm, faith, improvement, relationships, and mandatory. I get a feeling that the mandatory part of her life, the things she has to do, but don't add value, those faith and improvement and relationship areas of our lives, those tend to add a lot of value when we're doing those. So we don't really want to crush those, but streamlining the routine, streamlining those things we have to do that are just on the list, just like Janet related, really seems to be her focus. And I commend her for consciously going after those. And she says, having a definite end to my day is useful. I wonder what that means.
When I hear Kathryn's story, I think of, especially if I have children at home, would be a definite time for them to go to bed. They're not staying up as late as I'm going to be staying up. And so by getting them to bed at a specific time, that leaves me, maybe it's even if it's just 1 or 2 hours before I would go to bed, I have time to myself to maybe do something that I would love to do and not necessarily something that I just have to do. So I see that as maybe time for her to do something for her.
Sure.
Whatever that might be.
And we all need that quiet time. So we've streamlined our routine, and we've got a definite end of the day, the definite end. We all like that. Some people need morning time. Some people, she evidently is a night person, would like to get the kids in bed, have some quiet time, maybe watch TV, maybe read a book, maybe pay some bills, maybe just think, maybe just relax. So that's important. I think we can pick up on the feelings that are building here. You know, I've streamlined my day. I've got a definite end of the day. That's really important to me. But then she continues with some recommendations. Mm-hmm. What's the first recommendation that Kathryn brings up?
And I've learned never to turn down an offer of help.
Never. Now that is tough. For some of us that are self-sufficient, can that be a challenge to really ask someone for help or let them help?
I know just with my basic personality, I tend to be kind of a super mom type person where I just know that if I could just get a little more organized or get, that I would be able to get all of the stuff I need to done. And to be honest, it's really hard to ask someone for help because you feel like that they think you're not very capable, or it kind of starts to work on your self-esteem some. So if we just feel like we can convince ourselves we can do it all, then we don't have to ask for any help from anyone.
Yeah, help from anyone. But that's one of the core. If you are time crunched or have seasons of time crunch, whether it's at work, we're talking about a home situation here, but transfer that to work. Transferring is one of the key steps in the 7 steps to time excellence. Transferring that offer of help is very important. And it's one that we often forget. And so the transfer is one that we want to absolutely remember today and think about those people that can and would help us. Now, Kathryn recommends the type of help we should be looking for. So she gets really, I think, into her personal life. And continuing her quote,
"The only tip I would add is to make sure you have at least two friends who are or have been in your own situation."
Okay. So two friends that are in your situation, not three, not four, but she's thinking about what has worked in her life, and she's going to talk about two types of friends. Well, she finishes with a description of those two key friend types, and we want to kind of gather some, glean some information. The first friend type, as she continues to quote,
"One should be at the same stage of life as you, so you can not only swap childcare and meals, but have those 'I know how you're feeling' conversations."
Okay, so I think the conversation here is opening up. She's looking for someone in a similar situation. What advantage would that have?
Well, I just remember back when our kids were small again that I had a neighbor. She lived about two streets over, and I got to know her, and she had children actually about the same age as our kids. And there were times that I would watch her children while she maybe either ran errands or did something. Maybe it was just something that she wanted to do for herself. And then she would help watch our kids while I could get out and do something that maybe I didn't want to take the children to do at the time. So I just know that that was extremely beneficial for me. And quite frankly, there were other times we'd just get together and talk about our day, or maybe it was getting some advice on something our children were doing. Anyway, we spent time sharing, and that was a really good outlet for me, because sometimes it's easy to feel very isolated when you have children at home and you're not able to get out very easily.
Okay. So what I'm hearing here, the swapping childcare and meals, those are part of the transfer of duties. Those will relieve time off you and we can share. So it's a win-win situation. If you're already going to school or to childcare and you pick up my child, you've relieved me today, and tomorrow it might be the same. So that's a mathematical time savings. That's a key principle in time excellence. But as you said, Janet, she goes deeper. "I know what you're feeling" conversations. And you said, you know, those conversations are valuable. That's the kind of moral support that everyone needs. And sometimes you've just got to compare notes and talk things through. It helps.
It really helps. Even if the person is just listening, it just helps to have someone to talk to kind of unload on, so that you don't bottle up those feelings inside, and they know where you're coming from.
Right. So that is pretty much a support role. We've almost entered in the firm example we talked about of the priorities in our life. This is supporting, I'll call, relationships. This is supporting relationships with a positive output toward the transfer of time and the sharing of time. And in her case, her husband might be a logical help, but
he's gone a lot.
You know, guilty as charged. Janet reminded me of a time that I was working hard. At that same time, I was driving an hour and working from 6 in the morning till about 9, 10 at night. I'd drag in at home. Some days she reminded me I wouldn't see the kids. Now, that wasn't for it was for enough time, but it wasn't for like a whole career. It was for a few focused years that really, I think I was not in balance. I was not in balance with priorities. And those balancing is what we talk about when we review our priorities in the firm analogy. We think about, again, those faith anchors in our lives that are important, those improvement anchors and those relationship anchors. The mandatory we certainly want to crush. But that's only one friend type. So what's the other friend type?
The other should be a mom with grown or almost grown children who can offer the kind of wisdom and perspective that only come with years of experience. I think one thing that's important when we think about this is it doesn't take someone who's a lot older, but someone who's already been through those experiences. So if I'm a 25-year-old with two small children at home, someone that's 35 or 40 that's kind of already brought their children up through that stage that I'm in, that can be a mentor to me. It doesn't have to be someone that's one or two generations older. It could just be someone that's had the experiences, have moved through the experiences that I'm in now, and that can look back on those and can help show me or provide me with some wisdom that they have learned, even if it was just 5 or 10 years ago that they learned that. So sometimes we get caught up in, oh, an older person has to be my mom's age or my grandma's age. No, it really doesn't. It just has to be someone who has gone through that stage that you're at and that can share the experiences that they had. So, and it is really, really nice because they are not in the throes of what you're doing. So they can actually look back and say, this worked for me, or wow, that didn't work for me. So I found that extremely helpful. I was fortunate enough to have my mom who lived in town. And so I had that as someone that could be my mentor. But I also had people that were 10 to 15 years older than I was that I could rely on to help give me good advice too. So,
sure. Wisdom and perspective are important. From a technical side, don't forget, we're now in asking for help with someone that's in a different life stage. So there might actually be some nice balancing of time availability. They're in a different stage, so that they may have different slots open that the one that's in your same life stage, you're crashing the same type schedules, but these people are maybe out of Little League baseball. They might be out of taking care of children at a level that the kids are older or even gone, and they're not burdened with that, so they've got that time available. So I think Kathryn hits a couple great points here. Yeah. Just for a second, though, let's go on the other side. You know, we talk about time and we talk about time opportunities. So this is, Kathryn is on the receiving side. But can any of us relate to the opportunities that we might have to help others? So to be sensitive to the Kathryns of the world that may not ask you, but is actually needing help. And we can turn that into a time opportunity and actually push ourselves into those and really offer help when normally we wouldn't be sensitive to that. We're in a different life stage. So I think these two friend types really highlights a great opportunity. And Kathryn is pushing forward in her life and is sharing what I think sounds like some really personal advice that has worked in her life. And I think it transfers. And it transfers even to work. So forget just for a moment, but at work, do we not need mentors? Do we not need people who have been there to give advice? Do we not need coworkers that we can bounce ideas, different departments that we can huddle and assist each other? Because at the end of the day, we usually at work don't have enough time for everything. We can't get everything done, and we've got to engage the coworkers we have. We've got to engage a lot of people, and we've got to draw from experience. So this is a great session on transferring for time excellence, transferring those time duties and joining together where it totally makes sense, and supporting each other in a mentoring friendship, equal coexistence, that we can provide that emotional and support that just adds value.
And I think one thing to remember is really it's a win-win, not only for the person that is the recipient of the mentoring, but the mentor themselves actually receives a great benefit. So it's actually a win-win for both people. Whether you're the one being helped or the one helping, you both win. Okay. From a personal growth standpoint.
All right, so how do we summarize? Kathryn, thumbs up, thumbs down?
I think Kathryn gets a thumbs up on
thumbs
this
up.
One.
Absolutely. Good job. It's people like her that are trying to improve, that are researching, that are communicating, and trying to become better with their time for what's important. And there are situations that we each have that are unique. And in her case, she had a situation that, although she feels unique, is very common among us. So some great time excellence lessons and a great piece of advice that hopefully you can take home and take to the office and apply in your life. Time excellence, maximizing our time to make more of a difference through game-changing organizational career and personal growth. Take the next step. Save your spot in our free Time Excellence Training webinar, revealing the 3 phases and 7 steps to your new tomorrow at douglascalvin.com/webinar. And welcome back. That was a great episode, and I really appreciate Janet helping out and bringing color commentary to the whole situation. We stand back and we think about our challenge, and we once again remind ourselves that our challenge is to use our time and our opportunities the best way that we can. Remember that we don't have the same situations, but we can apply the same principles, and we can do the best we can with what we have. And that's what we're all about. Also, we have some action items for this session, because Kathryn's story inspires us and also gives us some great tips. We want to remember what we've learned, and let's go through a few of those. First of all, we want to remember, as she said, to streamline our routines. We talked about firm, the faith, improvement, the relationships, and the mandatory. Well, when she talks about routines, mandatory comes to mind, and we want to be able to compress those. So think about your day and where can you compress those routine, focus, non-career type items. Remember to ask for help. And when we ask for help, we're able to transfer. That's step 3 of 7. Transfer the work, the assignment to someone else. Not only do they get to help and get that appreciation that we can transfer, and in most situations, it's a win-win. Our time will come up, and both can gain from transferring the tasks to others and asking for help. Most importantly, at both home and at work, we learn from Kathryn that peers can help us. Peers can help us in our time, and they can help us to relate and share common experiences. We learned that mentors can also help. So they add wisdom, they've been through it, and those situations work all around. So we want to remember to have mentors and look for those mentors and foster those relationships. take one more step forward. Big action item. We don't have to do big things, but we've learned a lot today. We've learned how to look at time, and Kathryn's advice brings us some real practical experience toward how we might improve our time excellence. Just one step. Don't try and get the whole thing. Just free up 10, 15, 20 minutes just at this time. And if we keep adding that, if you keep listening to this, these sessions, we're going to gradually step through the concepts that will help you really get closer to your time excellence goals. Remember to visit us at douglascalvin.com, and there you can see webinar signups and free things are there. For the webinars, we do go through the three phases and seven steps in some more detail. So that's at douglascalvin.com/go/webinar. And on our site, you can get to our Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and YouTube links. If you receive value, would you help us by interfacing with us, interacting with us in some way? That could be a comment, that could be a share, that could be a retweet. You could friend us, you could thumbs up us, you could click, you could subscribe, you could buy something from one of our affiliates. All of these actions get us on the news feeds and get this free information out to more people just like yourself. So I encourage you to really get involved and help out in the whole cause of time excellence. Time excellence, maximizing your time to make more of a difference. I'm Douglas Calvin. Thanks for joining. And until next time, we will see you then. Bye-bye.